this series called Creation to the Cross, the Story of Redemption. I forget that every week, I forget this. Marty has Bibles up, the ushers have Bibles. If you don't have a Bible, you want to follow along, grab a Bible, we'll be in Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. If you were back there waving at me, Marty, I think I just forget again, so thank you. Creation of the cross. We're looking at from the beginning of Genesis through the New Testament, how the Bible points all the way to Jesus. The Old Testament stories all point to Jesus. And today we are in one of the most foundational messages or passages, Exodus chapter 3, where Moses meets Yahweh. And this will set the foundation for the whole rest of the series. And so I'm thrilled you're here today to walk through this passage with me. So in light of that, I want to do a name association. You know how you say a word and it makes you think of something? I'm going to give you some names. Now, if you have negative thoughts about these names, don't blurt it out. Just kind of shake your head, okay? So, first of all, my favorite actor, Denzel Washington. Woo-hoo. Some things come to your mind. See head shaking. Some things come to your mind when you hear. Did someone just kind of hoot and holler at his name? Okay, this is church. So, how about this one? Bill Cosby. So if I said Bill Cosby 5 years ago, yay! If I said Bill Cosby this year, we go, ooh. You see, character of a person projects a thought about that person. We can go on and on. I could say Bernie Sanders, Hillary Clinton, I'm Donald Trump. And I know for every one of you, I'd get boos or yays out of those names. Names communicate information. They communicate reputation. They communicate emotion to us. And so, I want to talk about the name of God today. We're going to start with a verse out of Joel, actually. It'll be on the screen. This is Joel chapter 2, verse 32. And the context is God is very upset with Israel. Very upset with Israel because they're worshiping idols and won't stop. So God's going to bring a plague of locusts on them. And he talks about being the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord is a time period when God's wrath comes upon the earth and his salvation comes to the earth. But the day of the Lord is coming upon Israel with this locust plague. But if you want deliverance from this locust plague, then you read this verse. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. This is the idea, not salvation as we look at it today, eternal life. This is salvation saved from the locust plague, the wrath of God. But you see the word the Lord there, all capital letters? That's the name of God. And it's in all capital letters, because for whatever reason, our translations seldom, if ever, translate his name, actually. His name is Yahweh. So you put the next slide up, if you would, Edie. You see, all capital letters in the Old Testament is the name Yahweh. It's just four consonants in Hebrew. Y-H-W-H. This is the name God gave himself. We're going to look at that story today. When you see the word Lord, capital L, the lowercase O-R-D, that is the Hebrew word Adonai, which simply is like our English word Lord, referring to a boss, someone very senior to you. Could be used with God, could be used with someone else. Like in Britain, they have lords. You know, that would be similar to Adonai. But every time you see the word Lord, all capital letters, in Hebrew, it's the name of God. And for some reason, Yahweh, for some reason, the old pronunciation was Jehovah. We're not going to go into the difference between those two today. But if you've been a Christian a long time and read and used to the King James language, Jehovah, the old songs that we sang. But I want to argue today that we need to restore this name to our vocabulary. Because when we hear this name, it's supposed to flood our minds with content and emotion of who he is. So, Teresa's up front. I'm going to pick on her. She doesn't know this. She just gave me the look. She has a name, Teresa. It communicates so much to me. All right? So, but what if I never addressed her by her name? What if I simply said, wife, man, lady, hey, you? That's how you do it? Well, that's my name. That's my name. Appreciate that. See, for me never to call her by her name is to miss who she is. So for me just to give her titles, mom, wife, things like that, describes some things about her, but it's not at her core who she is. She is Teresa, and everything that comes with that about her. So I want to argue with you today, not argue, suggest to you today, we must restore the name of God, Yahweh, in all that it brings to our hearts and minds. Because he is our Savior. We'll see that in this service that we will get to the New Testament, and Jesus is Yahweh. So with that, we're going to jump right in. The theme of the book of Moses, the theme of the book of Exodus, is the question, who is Yahweh? Alright? Exodus is about Moses coming to Pharaoh and say, let my people go. Moses coming to Pharaoh and quoting Yahweh. Yahweh says to you, Pharaoh, let my people go. And listen to what Pharaoh says to Moses. Chapter 5, verse 2. After he says, let my people go, Pharaoh says, who is Yahweh that I should obey his voice to let Israel go? I do not know Yahweh, and besides, I will not let Israel go. So, here's what happens. Pharaoh hears the word from Yahweh, let my people go, and Pharaoh says, who are you? I don't even know who you are. I'm not listening to you. So right then, Pharaoh drew the line in the sand. He drew the line in the sand and says, I will not let you step over this line, Yahweh. These are my people. They're not your people. They're my slaves. I will not let them go. And so that very interaction in chapter 5 sets the theme for the whole book. When Pharaoh says, who is Yahweh? The rest of the book is about showing Pharaoh who Yahweh is. And by doing so, he shows Israel who he is. The great and almighty God who led them out of slavery and captivity into the land of promise. So we're going to spend 5 sermons on the book of Exodus to take you from this journey from today, Exodus 3, all the way through the giving of the law and the ratification of the law, that God sets up Israel as his people and delivers them. So 5 sermons on this book. So let's start chapter 2 at the end, verse 22. Let me give this setup. So we know that it opens up with this. Because if Joseph had come to Egypt with 70 of his family members, and they were seen as privileged people, but over several hundred years, they grew rapidly and became very unpopular with the Egyptians. Because now they've grown in such numbers, they're a threat to the Egyptians. At least the Egyptians think so. And so there's a verse in chapter 1, verse 8, says, a Pharaoh rose up that did not know Joseph. Okay? The old King James. A Pharaoh who knew not Joseph. And in light of that, he brings hardship upon them, slavery, hard labor, and makes them his slaves to build his big cities. So a Pharaoh who knew not Joseph. As the story goes on, Israel continues to grow because God is blessing them, just as he promised Abraham. Abraham, I'm going to give you more children than the stars. That is continuing to happen even in slavery. So Pharaoh, in order to stop this, tells the midwives, you kill every male child born to the Israelites. And even with that, they continue to prosper. But Moses' mother protects Moses. And so Moses grows up actually in Pharaoh's household as Pharaoh's nephew. You see, Pharaoh's sister raises Moses in Pharaoh's household. He gets the education of an Egyptian prince. And so Moses then has a struggle with seeing his people mistreated. And you know the story. He ends up in the desert for 40 years with the Jethro, his father-in-law's sheep. And this is where we enter the story. Chapter 2, verse 22. Now it came about in the course of those many days that the king of Egypt died, and the sons of Israel sighed because of their bondage. And they cried out, and their cry for help because of their bondage rose up to God. So God heard their groaning. Look at these. God heard their groaning. God remembered his covenant with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And God saw the sons of Israel, and God knew. I changed that translation at the end. My translation says, and God took notice of them. But the Hebrew simply says, and God knew. What I want to show you here is, who is Yahweh? The first thing God is going to communicate to us is God is faithful to his promises. God is faithful to his promises. The first thing we see in the book of Exodus. When the passage ends with God knew, what did the Pharaoh say about Joseph? I don't know who Joseph is. I have no concept of these people's history. The Pharaoh knew not Joseph. But we get to the end of this chapter, chapter 2, and it says that God knew. He knows his people, and he remembers his promises to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So God will always, always fulfill his promises. And this is the very first thing I want us to realize today, because I just don't want this to be information. I have a lot of information today. My goal is not simply to put information in front of you. My goal is to get deeper than your mind into your heart and into my heart to realize that when God makes promises to us, he will keep them. God always does what he promises. Now, I think you could probably tell me stories in your life that, oh yeah, but what about in this time of my life? What about when my mother passed away? What about my child got sick? God didn't heal him. All these things, we say, is God really faithful to me? And we're going to see in the book of Exodus, Israel constantly challenges God's faithfulness, constantly. You see, God brings a lot of circumstances on Israel, we're going to see over the next 5 weeks, where there's great hardship in their life, and that hardship actually increases from this time to when God delivers them. And they doubt him. They say, did you bring us out of this wilderness just to kill us? You're not faithful. The first thing God wants his people to know, and us today, God is faithful. No matter what is happening in your life, no matter what is going on, God is faithful to his promises. Don't let your circumstances define who God is. Let your understanding of who God is from Scripture inform your circumstances. God is faithful. So then we get to chapter 3, and the story of the burning bush. So Moses is out in the back 40, literally, in the base of Mount Sinai, and he's got his father-in-law's sheep. And all of a sudden, he sees a bush. He sees a bush on fire, but it's not being consumed. So I don't know how far away he is. He's close enough to this bush to realize there's a fire. And imagine 50, 60, 80 yards out there, you see one of these small trees on fire. But the tree's not being consumed. And go, what the heck is going on here? And so you get real close to it. And this is what about God's holiness. God's holiness. In fact, your notes have said, God is holy, tread lightly. Let me tell you why here in verse 5. So out of the bush, God says, Moses, Moses. And whenever God says your name twice, there's something serious happening here. Moses says, here I am. Now picture this. This is not just a simple conversation. What would you do if you approach a bush that is on fire but not being consumed, and it speaks to you, and knows your name? Immediately, your heart rate's going to go up, fear's going to hit you, and what does Yahweh say to Moses? Verse 5. Then he said, do not come near here. Remove your sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy. He goes on to say, I am the God of your father, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Whenever you see that, that means God is saying, I'm faithful. I'll keep my promises to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Every time you see the phrase, I am the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God is saying, I'm faithful to my promises. But when he said, take off your shoes, you're on holy ground, what's Moses' response? He fell down in fear. He is afraid at this moment. Great fear grabs Moses, as it would you and I. So first we saw God is faithful, now we see God is holy. Take off your shoes, Moses. Now, Kim has her shoes off right now, which I'm not sure why, but I'm not sure what taking your shoes off fully implies. But it certainly implies a measure of humility, maybe even a measure of lack of strength. He's trying to walk in the Sinai Desert without his shoes on. Even the angels who are in God's presence, Isaiah 6, the seraphim who are in God's presence 24-7, it says that they have six wings. With two they cover their eyes because they can't look on God. With two they cover their feet. And with two they fly. So something about feet represents, I don't belong here at this moment. Moses fully believes at this moment, I do not belong in the presence of God. And we need to grasp that also. We are very used to the love and compassion of God. Amen? Mm-hmm. We are direct recipients of the love and compassion of God. I sometimes wonder, though, if we take his holiness for granted. We take his holiness for granted. His holiness says he is so different than us. And we don't even belong in his presence. But yet, he comes down to us. Let's never forget and presume upon the holiness of God and what that means for our daily life. I wonder sometimes also in our behavior, if we forget the holiness of God and how he is completely different than us, then it seems to be easier to violate his commands. Because he's loving, he's forgiving, he's gracious, he'll forgive me. How many times have you said that? How many times have I said that? That this temptation comes my way, and I think, you know, he forgave me last time. So I'm going to enter into this because he'll forgive me again. Now, I'm not doubting God's forgiveness, ever. But his holiness should make me step back on Moses and go, I need to be forgiven. I'm going to violate the King of the Universe's character. I better be in fear. That's what the holiness of God is supposed to do to us. So far we have faithfulness and holiness. As the story goes on, he tells Moses, I'm going to send you, I've seen the affliction of my people, I'm going to send you to Egypt, and you're going to tell Pharaoh that my people go, and you're going to lead the people out. Now, if you remember the story, Moses isn't real keen on this idea at all. And so, what we're going to look here, here's where God gives his name. And you notice I say this, God's name guarantees his presence and success in what he calls us to do. That's a long sentence. God's name, Yahweh, guarantees his presence and success in what he calls us to do. So let me read for you verses 10 to 15. We'll walk through this. So open your Bibles to this passage or turn your phones on, whatever it is you have a Bible on. Therefore, come now, and I will send you to Pharaoh so that he may bring my people, the sons of Israel, out of Egypt. Now, understand this. Moses has been gone 40 years. The Pharaoh that he was under when he was there is dead. Now, the Pharaoh is a title. It's like Caesar. It's not a personal name. So the new Pharaoh is the son of the old Pharaoh. Probably Moses grew up with him. So Moses was the prince. So he was technically cousins with this guy. So now this guy's in charge. Go back to this guy that you grew up with and tell him, let my people go. So you've got to get a picture here of how Moses must be feeling. He's already been hiding in the desert 40 years because his Pharaoh is trying to kill him. But Moses, verse 11, said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and that I should bring the sons of Israel out of Egypt? You know, at one level, this is the right thing to say. I don't have the ability to do this, God. Who am I? Who am I? As opposed to, you picked the right man here. I don't even need you, God. I can do this. Moses is at the other end of the pendulum. Who am I to do this? And here's what Yahweh says to him. Certainly, I will be with you. You see, it's underlined up there. Remember that phrase. Underline it in your Bibles if you don't mind writing in your Bibles. I will be with you. And this shall be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God at this mountain. Moses said to God, behold, I am going to the sons of Israel. And then not stop there. He's not making a commitment. He's given a hypothetical. So one translation says, okay, let's put up a hypothetical situation, God. If I go, that's how I want you to see this. Where am I? If I am going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, now they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? This communicates a ton of information. Israel doesn't know the name of their own God. They've been in slavery for 400 years. They have forgot the name of their God. They don't know who they worship. They don't know who they claim to worship. So, if I go, Moses doesn't even know it. If I go, they're going to ask me, oh yeah, our God sent you? What's his name? Verse 14. And God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Now, the chapters go on with Moses' reluctance. He does not want to do this. I'm sure there's a measure of fear in him. Why would I go back to the place I've been hiding from for 40 years? And go back and confront the very people who want to kill me and tell them to let their slaves go, the slaves that are making their country prosperous. Why in the world would I do this? I have no ability. He goes on to say, I can't even talk well. I have a stuttering problem. Every excuse after another telling God, I'm not the guy. But God originally said, I will be with you. And then Moses says, what's your name? He says, I am. Edie, would you put that slide up? The next one. The one that compares them. Oh, these are, you don't have together? Okay, so go back. Go back. I am is his name. In chapter 12, the next slide, Edie, it says, I will be. I want these to be together. I want you to see that. When he promises Moses, I will be with you, Moses said, what's your name? He says, I am. It's the exact same word to me. When Moses says, I can't do this, God says, I will be with you. Who are you? I am. The word I will be and I am is the exact same name in Hebrew, the exact same word. See, Hebrew doesn't have a tense system like English does. Hebrew has two tenses, perfect and imperfect. And time is not inherent in it like our tense system. When I say I will be, it's inherently future tense, right? When I say I am, it's inherently present tense. Hebrew doesn't have that. So translators determine whether it's future tense or present tense. They determine that and translate it. So we don't know in English, it's the exact same word. When God makes a promise to Moses, I will be with you, and God says, what's your name? He says the exact same word. He wants Moses to know that my name, at the heart of my name, represents my presence with you. And you will succeed in what I'm calling you to do. Moses, you can't do this on your own, but I am with you. I can do this in you, with you, and for you. You must trust in me. So the name Yahweh, at its heart, at its core, is the idea of God's presence is with you, and not just presence with you as you fail, but God's presence is with you in success in what he calls you to do and what he calls you to be. If you think through the Old Testament Paul, not the Old Testament, New Testament Paul, in Philippians chapter 4, Paul says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. He's bringing the exact same theology into the New Testament. Whatever God calls me to do, I can do because he strengthens me. So the name Yahweh, this is so important right now, the name Yahweh, I will be with you. What is your name? I am. That is the simple name Yahweh. His name is a verb. The most common verb in any language, I am. And it's a promise of his presence. I want to take you through a few more verses to show you this. Look at Joshua chapter 1, verse 5. We'll actually preach on this in about 6 weeks. Joshua 1, 5. Joshua's taken over from Moses. And here's what, Joshua doesn't want to do this either. Joshua's been given an impossible task. Moses is given an impossible task. Go deliver my people from Egypt. Are you kidding me? I can't do that. I am with you, Moses. You will succeed because I am with you. It's at the core of my identity. It's at the core of my name. Moses ends up dying. Joshua takes over. Joshua, you're going to take the children of Israel into the promised land and displace all those nations. Joshua goes, what are you, nuts? With this ragtag group of people, you want me to do this? What does God say to him? Joshua 1:5, no man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Just as I have been with Moses, I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. That's the promise of God's name. He calls you to be something, he calls you to do something. And he is with you, he will never leave you, he will never fail you, he will never forsake you. And we're going to see at the end of this message what we would call you. And the same promise is still true today. But stop for a moment and realize that. Whatever your family situation is, whatever your life has been like, or people have let you down, and maybe even people you love have failed you, maybe people who you love have abandoned you. And we tend to project that to our God. We take our human experiences and then project that to maybe God is that way too. And here's one of the most important truths of the Bible. God says, I'm with you, I will never leave you, I will never fail you, I will never forsake you. Do you believe this? I was reading something recently about someone who was criticizing Christianity, saying Christians are Christians in name only. Because the Bible tells us all sorts of things we are to do and believe. And we give lip service to them, but we don't actually believe them. When it says that it's better to serve than to be served, we claim that. Do you really believe that? It's better to give than to receive. We claim that. Do we really believe that? See, there's so many things said in the Bible that we quote as, I'm a Christian, I believe this, but our life reflects the exact opposite. So when God says, I will never leave you or forsake you, do you believe that? And if you truly grasp the presence of God in your life, the great I Am, the great Yahweh, is with you for eternity. He makes a covenant with you, he keeps it. You're faithless, he is faithful. He will never leave you or forsake you. Do you believe that? This is Isaiah 41. Do not fear, for I am. God is talking to now the people who are coming back out of captivity, out of Babylon, coming back to the promised land. And they're full of fear because they've been living in captivity for generations. They're full of fear. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not anxiously look about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. Surely I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Drop down to verse 13. For I am Yahweh, your God, who upholds your right hand, who says to you, do not fear, I will help you. If you go on a Bible Gateway, if you don't have a computer program that has a search engine on it, go to Bible Gateway and simply plug in the words, I am with you, or I will be with you. And dozens of times you're going to find examples of God saying, I am Yahweh, I am with you. I am Yahweh, I will be with you. I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you. You can always count on me. That's at the heart of the name of God. It's all through the scripture. Now that you see this, as you read your Bible, you're going to see this everywhere. I am with you. I will never leave you. I will be with you. When I give you a job to do, I will be with you. You can trust me. That's the heart, the character of our God. So, now verse 15 of Exodus 3, back there. After he tells him, I am, has sent me to you. Verse 15, and this is why I'm having this sermon today. God furthermore said to Moses, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, the Lord, and that is the word Yahweh. So this is a slightly different form grammatically. And this is the one that's stuck that occurs 7,000 times in the Old Testament. The Lord, his name Yahweh. The Lord, Yahweh, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. Here it is. This is my name forever. This is my memorial name to all generations. What does it mean to have a memorial name? Think about that. A memorial name. In other words, there's a name that associates with God. So something should flood your memory about who this God is simply by hearing his name. For whatever reason, in history of translations, that the name Yahweh was translated Lord. Part of that goes all the way back to the 3rd century BC, where the Israelites coming back out of captivity did not want to say the name of God, because you see, they abused the name of God. The third commandment is, thou shalt not take the name of Yahweh, your God, in vain. So they had a solution. In order not to break that commandment, we won't say his name. We won't say his name. And as well-meaning as that was, they put a restriction on themselves that God never required of them. God wants us to know his name. He wants us to say his name. He wants us to live in the memorial meaning of his name. So that's why you're always going to hear me say when I read, especially the Old Testament, where the name occurs 7,000 times, and our translations say the Lord, you're always going to hear me say Yahweh. We need to restore the name of God in our vocabulary. And with the name of God, we need to restore the meaning, the idea that God is faithful, God is holy, God has promised to never leave us or forsake us. And whatever he calls us to do, he is with us the entire way to give us the ability to do what he's called us to do. There's one last point I want to look at. Yahweh is gracious and compassionate. For this one, we're going to jump to Exodus 33. Exodus 33. This is a great story. You've heard it before. I've mentioned it before. So, in Exodus 3, Moses doesn't know the name of God. He doesn't know it. But now, we're getting to the end of Moses' life, and he's come to know Yahweh intimately. Intimately. And so, he wants to know, if I can see you, give me more of you, God. Give me more. So this is what Moses asked for. Let's start verse 18. Then Moses said, I pray to you, show me your glory. So Moses wants greater experience of Yahweh than he's had so far. Show me your glory. And here's what Yahweh says. Look at verse 19 of Exodus 33. I myself will make all my goodness pass before you, and will proclaim the name of Yahweh before you, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will show compassion on whom I will show compassion. But he said, you cannot see my face, for no one, no man can see me and live. See, Moses says, show me your glory. God says, you can't see my face. If you see my face, you will die. Now, understand, God doesn't have a face. He doesn't have a face, doesn't have a back, doesn't have arms, doesn't have legs, but he uses that imagery because that's how we communicate with each other. When I look at you face to face, there's an intimacy face to face. If you turn your back on me, I can know something about you, but I can't know you fully intimately because the face represents my identity. You with me on this? And basically, God is saying to Moses, I want to give you what you can handle, Moses, but you cannot fully handle my full presence. To see my glory, to see all of me, you will die. Remember the movie, The Raiders of the Lost Ark? The ending of it. I know this is a generational thing, but I think this movie is so popular, even the younger generation has seen it. What happens when the Nazis open the Ark of the Covenant at the end? They melt. It's one of the early, you know, computer-generated animations that was, now we laugh at it, but then, whoa! See, and that's what's going to happen to Moses. If I show you all that I am, Moses, you will melt. You can't handle it. So I'm going to show you what you can handle, my mercy and my compassion. And then, if we look a little bit later, when he does this, go to chapter 34, verse 5, when he actually passes in front of Moses, here's what God says. Then Yahweh descended in the cloud and stood there with him as he called upon the name of Yahweh. Then Yahweh passed by in front of him and proclaimed, Yahweh, Yahweh, God, compassionate and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness, who keeps loving kindness for thousands, who forgives iniquities, transgressions, and sin, yet he will by no means leave the guilty unpunished, visiting the iniquity of the fathers on the children and on the grandchildren to the third and fourth generation. So here we see it's all wrapped together, the character of Yahweh. He is a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness. You've experienced this day in and day out. God is gracious and compassionate. I think we're so used to this concept we forget. Let me ask you a question. Why are you still breathing today? So, two quick stories about God's holiness. Numbers 15 and Acts 5. Numbers 15, a guy picks up sticks on the Sabbath. All right, he's just trying to get some firewood for his family. And Moses catches them, or the people of Israel catch them. God's already said, you do not work on the Sabbath, you do nothing on the Sabbath, and if you do, you will die. He brings a death penalty for working on the Sabbath. So this guy forgot to pick up firewood on day 6, picks up firewood on day 7, he gets caught. Moses comes before Yahweh and says, what do we do with him, God? And God says, you know the answer to that. I already told you what we do with him. Kill him. They put this man to death for picking up sticks on the Sabbath. How many of you have done worse than that on the Sabbath? So why are you still reading to them? Acts chapter 5, Ananias and Sapphira. Christians who are like any other Christians, they have a divided heart. They want to do what's right, but they also want glory for themselves. So they sell some property, take it to the apostles and for benevolence. They give all the money to the apostles to give away to the poor. When in fact they didn't. They kept some back for themselves. That wasn't the problem. They said they gave it all. They lied. They wanted self-glory. What happens to them? Fell over dead by fellow people. How many of you have lied for self-glory? I see three hands. Come on. Why are we still breathing then? Why are we still alive? It's because God is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in loving kindness. And he relents concerning calamity. His graciousness and his mercy overwhelm our sins. But every once in a while, it says he will not let the guilty go unpunished. Every once in a while, he says, you know what? You've presumed upon my mercy too many times. I'm going to bring the full consequences into your life that your sin has chosen. And those of those days, we cry out, oh God, have mercy on me. Have you ever been there? Ever done something, all of a sudden you realize, if I get caught with this, my life is toast? Our relationships are toast. Oh God, have mercy. He does. Let's not presume upon his mercy. Israel presumed upon it time and time and time again. And I would suggest to you that we do the same thing today. We can always talk about, oh, Israel, their failure. They're simply us. Okay? We are dead. To the name of Yahweh, it communicates faithfulness, holiness, a promise of his presence and success in what he calls us to do, because he'll never leave us or forsake us, and his graciousness and compassionate. Every time you hear the word Yahweh, I want you to remember those things. He is faithful. He is holy. He is with you, never leave you or forsake you. He is merciful, gracious, and compassionate. Someone say amen.
Amen.
So what I want to do now, just to end this service, I want to show you how, this is a sermon series on how it all points to Jesus. Jesus is Yahweh. It's right in your notes. Jesus is Yahweh. John 8:58 says this, truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am. Now, what's the context of that story? He's been arguing with the Jewish leaders for the whole chapter of 8. The whole 8th chapter. Better grammar there. Because they're denying who he is. And finally, he says to them, you know what, Abraham has seen my day, and he was glad. And they look at him and go, you're nuts. You're not even 50 years old yet. And you claim to have seen Abraham? You see, Abraham lived 2,000 years before Jesus. And he says, Abraham has seen my day, and he rejoiced. Because you see, Jesus was Yahweh who actually talked to Abraham. So when Jesus says, before Abraham was born, I am, the next verse, verse 59, says they picked up rocks to kill him. They know he's committing blasphemy. They know what he's saying is damnable if he is not Yahweh. He didn't say, before Abraham was born, I existed. This is what a crazy person would say. I'm 2,000 years old. He said, before Abraham was born, I am. He claims the name of God. Romans chapter 10, turn there. Romans 10. I started this sermon with the phrase from Joel, who calls upon the name of Yahweh, will be saved. I did that because of the way we're going to end this. Romans 10, in one simple verse, tells us how we are saved. Romans 10, 9. If you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. What does it mean to confess Jesus as Lord? I want to argue, Paul is saying you will confess Jesus as Yahweh. Not simply as a boss, but you will confess Jesus as Yahweh. And the reason I say that is because 3 verses later, in verse 14, verse 13, he quotes Joel, whoever will call upon the name of the Lord will saved. So how do you get saved? You confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Well, who is Lord? Whoever calls upon the name of Yahweh will be saved. God brings in that passage from Joel to identify the Lord with Jesus. You see, for us to become fully devoted followers of Jesus Christ, to truly grasp what our salvation is, we have to grasp Jesus is Yahweh. John 8:15, I am. We call upon his name to be saved. No one else can save us. No one else can save us but Yahweh. Jesus is Yahweh. So the last one, truly we are done. Matthew 28, go there. If you remember, I said that God gave Moses an impossible task. He told Moses, go back to the people who want you dead, people you've been hiding from for 40 years, and tell them, let my people go. Moses does it, and guess what happens? Because Yahweh keeps his promises, because Yahweh gives you the power to do what he calls you to do. Did you hear that? Yahweh gives you the power to do what he calls you to do. Moses succeeded. Joshua takes over. Now take the people in the promised land. Gave Joshua an impossible job. You want me to take these people into that land where there are armies and armies and multitudes of people, and you want me to chase them all out and take over their houses? Yep. That pretty much sums it up, Joshua. And no man will stand before you, because I am with you. I'll never leave you or forsake you. Joshua did it. Joshua over there did it. So now Jesus gives us a commission. Matthew 28. There's no one that has more authority than Jesus. No one can say to Jesus, you can't do that. All authority has been given to the resurrected Christ. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. How much? And lo, I love that word, I have no clue what it means. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. You see, here, now we've been given the possibility of that. Let's talk about the 12 disciples here. Here these guys, they live in the backwoods of the Roman Empire. Israel is on the edge of the Roman Empire. And these 12 are from Galilee. That's like being from West Virginia. And if you're from West Virginia, I apologize. So, you want us, who the world looks at as fools, to go take over the world with the gospel? That's what you're telling us, Jesus? Yep. You 12, you take this gospel to the ends of the earth, and I am with you always. If God's promise to Moses, I am with you, the very heart of his name, is a promise of success, and God's promise to Joshua, I am with you, a promise of success, then Yahweh becomes human, dies, is buried, and raised again. And all authority is given to him as the God-man. And now he calls these 12, by extension the 12, the next generation, the next generation, the next generation. But we are to go to the ends of the earth. You know, by the time these 12 died, the Roman Empire, the gospel had gone all the way to Rome. By the end of that first century, the second century, it had gone to Britain. By the third century, the emperor became saved, supposedly. Christianity is made legal, and Christianity takes over the Roman Empire. In a little over 200 years, these 12 take the gospel and accomplish that. And each generation picked up the mantle. And today, we have 7 billion people on earth. We have an awful lot of people who've never even heard of the gospel. They may have heard the name Jesus, but do they really grasp that Jesus is the Yahweh of eternity who's come down and become human to save his people from their sins and to bring new life to them and to give them eternal life that starts now and goes on forever? And he's called us now, the 100 people in this room or so, to go to the ends of the earth, and I am with you. So, when I said before, we Christians claim things that we will live out. We say we believe something, we will live it. Do you understand that you've been given a commission to take the gospel to the ends of the earth? Whether you go, or you give, you pray, whatever your role is. And when we say, is that a doable job? Can we really do that? No, we can't. But I can do all things through Christ who has called me and strengthens me. Let's pray together. Father, thank you today for your word. And I pray, Lord, that for me, that I've learned not to simply have lots of information that I claim to believe and live my life. I pray that for all of us here today, Father, that something in your word today would grab us. And that we'd say, yes, we believe this, and we will step into it, and we will live it. Give us that mercy. Give us that power through your spirit. Give us that heart. Heart for the lost, a heart for our neighbors, to take the love of Jesus to them. So, we're yours, Father. We're yours. Have your way.